Mr. London, to your chamber.
Welcome, dear cousin, my lord sovereign. The weary way hath made you melancholy.
No, uncle. I want more uncles here to welcome me.
Sweet prince, the untainted virtue of your years have not yet dived into the world's deceit. Those uncles which you want were dangerous. Your grace attended to their sugar words, but look not on the poison of their hearts. God keep you from them and from such false friends.
God keep me from false friends, but they were none.
My lord, the mayor of London comes to greet you.
Well, God bless your grace and have a happy day.
I thank you, good my lord, and thank you all. I thought my mother and my brother York would long ere this have met us on the way. Fie, what a slug is Hastings that he comes not to tell us whether they will come or no.
Oh, in good time, here comes the sweating lord.
Welcome, my lord. What, will our mother come?
On what occasion? God, he knows, not I. The queen, your mother, and your brother York have taken sanctuary. The tender prince would have fain come with me to meet your grace, but by his mother was perforce withheld.
What an indirect and peevish course is this of hers?
My lord, come.
Will your grace persuade the queen to send the Duke of York unto his princely brother presently?
Should I deny Lord Hastings go with him and from her jealous arms pluck him perforce?
Heaven forbid we should infringe the holy privilege of blessed sanctuary. Not for all this land would I be guilty of so great a sin.
You are too senseless, obstinate, my lord. Too ceremonious and traditional. You break not sanctuary in seizing him. The benefit thereof is always granted to those whose dealings deserve the place.
And those who have the wit to claim the place.
This prince hath neither claimed it nor deserved it. Often I've heard of sanctuary men, but sanctuary children.
Better till now.
My lord, you have overruled my mind for once. Come on! Lord Hastings, will you go with me?
I go, my lord.
Say, Uncle Gloucester, if our brother come, where shall we sojourn till our coronation?
Where it seems best unto your royal self. If I may counsel you, some day or two your highness shall repose you at the Tower. And then where you please, and may be thought most fit for your best health and recreation.
I do not like the Tower of any place. Did Julius Caesar build that place, my lord?
He did. My gracious lord, begin that place, which since succeeding kings have re-added fun.
So wise, so young, they say, do never live long.
What say you, Uncle Gloucester?
I say without characters, fame lives long.
That Julius Caesar was a famous man. I'll tell you what, my cousin Buckingham.
What, my gracious lord?
And if I live until I be a man, I'll win our ancient right in France again. Or die a soldier, as I lived a king.
Short summers lightly have a forward spring.
In good time, here comes the Duke of York!
Richard of York, how fares our noble brother?
Well, my dear lord, so must I call you now.
Oh! How fares our loving cousin, noble lord of York!
I thank you, gentle uncle. Oh, my lord, you said that idle weeds were fast in growth. The prince, my brother, hath outgrown me far.
He hath, my lord.
And therefore is he idle?
I would not say so.
Then he is more beholding to you than I.
Well, he may command me as my sovereign, but you have power in me as in a kinsman.
I pray you, uncle, give me this dagger.
What? My weapon, little lord?
With all my heart.
What? Would you have my weapon, little lord?
I would, that I might thank you as you call me.
How?
Little.
Our Lord of York will still be cross in talk. Uncle Gloucester, your grace knows how to bear with him.
He means to bear me, not bear with me. Uncle, my brother mocks both you and me. Because that I am little like an ape, he thinks that you should bear me on your shoulders.
The shark provided witty reason. So cunning and so young, it is wonderful.
My lord, the peas you pass along.
Myself and my good cousin Buckingham will to your mother to entreat of her to meet you at the Tower and welcome you.
What? Go you unto the Tower, my lord?
My lord protector would have it so.
Oh, I shall not sleep in quiet at the Tower.
Why, what should you fear?
Marry, my uncle Clarence's angry ghost. Grandam said that he was murdered there.
I fear no uncle's dead.
Nor none that live, I hope.
And if they live, I hope I need not fear. But come, my lord, and go I into the Tower. My lord, think you this little prating York was not incensed by a subtle mother to scorn you thus appropriately?
No doubt. 'Tis a parlous boy. Bold, quick, ingenious, forward, capable. He's all the mothers from the top to the toe.
Well, let them rest. Catesby, come hither. Thou art sworn as deeply to affect what we intend, as closely to conceal what we impart. Thou knowest our reasons, dirged upon the way.
Well then, no more but this. Go, gentle Catesby, and as it were from far off, sound thou Lord Hastings, how he doth stand affected to our purpose. If he be leaden, icy, cold, unwilling, be thou so too, and break off the talk, and give us notice of his inclination.
Tell him, Catesby, tomorrow his ancient knot of dangerous adversaries, Rivers and Grey, shall have their blood let at Pomfret Castle.
Go, gentle Catesby.
Aye, my good lords both.
My lord, what shall we do if we perceive Lord Hastings will not yield to our complots?
Chop off his head, man. And look, when I am king, claim thou of me the earldom of Hereford, and the movables whereof the king my brother once possessed.
I will claim that promise at your grace's hand.
Come! Let us sup betimes, that afterwards we might digest our complots.
My lord! My lord?
Who knocks?
One from Lord Stanley.
What is the clock?
Upon the stroke of...
My lord Stanley sleep these tedious nights.
Then certifies your lordship that this night he dreamt that the boar had raised off his helm. Besides, he says there are two councils kept, and that may be determined at the one, which may make you and him
to rude!
He sends to know your lordship's pleasure. If you will presently take horse with him and with all speed post with him toward the north to shun the danger that he so divines.
Go, fellow. Go and return unto thy lord and bid him not fear the separated councils.
His honour and myself are at the one, and at the other is my good friend Catesby. Where nothing can proceed that toucheth us, whereof I shall not have intelligence.
Tell him his fears are shallow without instance. Go, bid thy master rise and come to me, and we will both together to the tower, where he shall see that the boar shall use us kindly.
Many good morrows to my noble lord.
Morrow, Catesby. You were early stirring. What news? What news from this our tottering state?
It is a reeling world indeed, my lord. And I believe we'll never stand upright till Richard wear the garland of the realm.
I'll wear the garland. Mean you the crown?
Aye, my lord.
I'll have this crown of mine cut from my shoulders before I see the crown so foul misplaced. Canst thou guess that he doth aim it?
Aye, on my life. And thereupon he sends you this good news. That this same very day, your enemies, Rivers and Grey, must die at Pomfret.
Indeed, I am no mourner for that news.
It is a vile thing to die, my gracious lord, when men are unprepared and look not for it.
Oh, monstrous! Monstrous! And so falls it out with Rivers and Grey. So 'twill do for some men else who think themselves as safe as thou and I, as thou knowest. Are dear to princely Richard and to Buckingham.
The princes both make high account of you.
I know they do. I have well deserved it. Oh, come on. Come on! Where is thy boar, spear man? Fear you the boar and go so unprovided?
Good morrow, my lord.
Good morrow, Catesby. You may jest on, but I do not like these several councils, I.
My lord, I hold my life as dear as yours. And never in my days, I do protest, was it so precious to me as it is now. Think you but that I know our state secure, I would be so triumphant as I am.
The lords at pulpit when they rode from London were jocund, and supposed their states were sure, and indeed they had no cause to mistrust. What, shall we toward the tower? The day is spent.
Come up with you. What you want, my lord? Today the lords you talk of are beheaded.
But come, my lord, let's away.
Today shall help the whole subject die for truth, for duty, and for loyalty.
God bless the prince from all the back of you. A knot you are of damned bloodsuckers.
No. Dispatch! The limits of your lives is out!
Oh, damn, Margaret's curse has fallen upon our heads!
Make haste! The hour of death is expiate! We give them the arguments for blood to drink and take our leave until we meet in heaven!
Now, noble peers, the cause why we are met is to determine in the coronation of young Edward when is the royal day.
All things ready?
They are, and what but nomination?
Tomorrow. Then I judge a happy day.
Who here is most inward with the noble duke? Who knows the protector's mind herein?
Oh, your grace, we think, should soonest know his mind.
We know each other's faces for our hearts. He knows no more of mine than I of yours, or I of his, my lord, than you of mine. Hastings! You and he are near in love.
I thank your grace. I know he loves me well, but for his purpose in the coronation, I have not sounded him. But you, honourable lords, may name the time, and in the Duke's behalf, I'll give my voice.
Oh, in happy time, here comes the Duke himself.
Ah, my noble lords and cousins all, good morrow. I've been long asleep. But I trust my absence doth neglect the great designs that by my presence might have been concluded.
Had you not come upon your cue, my lord, William Lord Hastings would have pronounced your part. I mean, your voice for crowning of the king.
Then my Lord Hastings?
No man might be bolder.
His lordship knows me well and loves me well. Ely, cousin of Buckingham, a word with you.
Bishop of Ely, when I was last in Holborn, I saw good strawberries in your garden there. I do beseech you, send for some of them.
Marry and will, my lord, with all my heart.
Catesby hath sounded Hastings in our business. Withdraw yourself a while, I'll go with you.
We have not yet set down this day of triumph. Tomorrow, in my judgment, is too sudden.
His grace looks cheerfully and smooth this morning. I think there's never a man in Christendom who can lesser hide his love nor hate than he. Straight by his face shall you know his heart.
I pray you all tell me what they deserve, and you conspire my death with devilish plots of damned witchcraft and have prevailed upon my body with their hellish charms.
The tender love I bear your grace makes me say they have deserved death.
Then be your eyes the witness of their evil. See how I am bewitched? Huh? Behold my arm. It's like a blasted sapling withered up,
And this is Edward's wife, that monstrous witch that by her witchcraft thus hath mocked me.
If she had done it.
If the protector of this damned strumpet, talkest thou to me of ifs? Thou art a traitor.
Oh! Off with his head. Now, if I say, Paul, I swear I will not dine until I see the safe. Catesby, see that it be done. The rest that love me, rise and follow me.
Lighted on poor Hastings' wretched head.
Oh, come, come, dispatch! The Duke could be at dinner. He longs to see your head.
Come, come, dispatch!
Tis bootless to exclaim.
Bloody Richard! Miserable England!
I can count of it the deep tragedy.
Tragedy.
Tragedy. Speak, look back, and cry on every side. Ghastly looks are at my service like enforced smile, and ready in their offices at any time.
Oh! What is cake's begone? He is, and he brings the mayor along. Be patient, it's our friend, it's Catesby.
Here's the head of that ignoble traitor. Dangerous and unsuspected. Hastings.
Sheltered traitor that ever lived. Would you imagine or almost believe that the subtle traitor this day had plotted to murder me and my good lord of Gloucester?
Had he done so?
What? Thinking that we were Turks or infidels? But that we would perceive us rashly. the peace of England and our person's safety enforced us to this execution.
Well, now fair before you, he deserved his death, and your good graces
well proceeded.
Hmm.
I would have had you heard the traitor speak
and timorously confess the manner and purpose of his treasons. You might well have signified the same
unto the citizens
who haply may misconster us and him
and wail his death.
I'll acquaint you, citizens, with your just proceedings in this case.
Mm.
Good Lord Mayor, we bid farewell.
After cousin of Buckingham, the mayor towards Guildhall, hies him in all post, there at the meet's advantage of the time, in further varsity of Edward's children. Tell him how Edward put to death a citizen, only for saying he would make his son heir to the crown. Urge his hateful luxury and bestial appetite in charge of lust, which stretched to their servants, daughters, wives. If you thrive well, meet me at Baynard's castle, where you shall find me well accompanied with reverend fathers and well-learned bishops.
I'll play the orator.
Go thou to Friar Painter. Bid him meet me within this hour at Baynard's castle.
My lord,
now will I go to give notice that no manner of person at any time shall have recourse into the prince's.
The citizens are mum and speak not a word.
What touched you the bastard?
I did.
It's children.
I did. The insatiate greediness of his desires, his tyranny for trifles, his own bastardy as being not your father then in France, his resemblance being not like the Jew. Withal, I did infer your lineaments, being the right idea of your father, both in your form and nobleness of mind, your victories in Scotland, your discipline in war, your bounty, virtue, fair humility. Indeed, left nothing fitting for your purpose.
Did they, sir?
So God help me, they spake not a word, but stared each other and looked deadly pale.
What tongueless blots were they? Would they not speak?
By my troth, I reprehended them and asked the mayor what meant this willful silence. He was then urged to tell my tale again. Thus saith the Duke, thus hath the Duke inferred. When he had done so, some followers of mine own at the low end of the hall held up their caps, and some 10 voices cried, "Long live King Richard!" Thus I took the advantage of those few, even here, break off and came away. Will not the mayor and his brethren come?
The mayor is here at hand. Intense of fear. And look you, get a prayer book in your hand. And stand you betwixt two churchmen. Good my lord,
be not easily won to our request. Play the maid's part. Still answer nay and take it.
I'll go.
Look, up to the leads, the Lord Mayor knocks.
Welcome, my lord.
I dance attendance here. I fear that you will not serve me, Lord.
Catesby, what says your lord to our request?
He doth entreat your grace, my noble lord, to visit him tomorrow or next day. He is within, with two right reverend fathers, divinely bent to meditation. And in no worldly suits would he be moved to draw him from his holy exercise.
Good Catesby, and tell your grace, myself, the mayor, and aldermen are here in deep design to matters of great moment, no less important than our general good. Are here to have some conference with his grace.
I'll signify so much in two minutes.
This prince is not an Edward.
He is not lolling on a lewd love bed, but on his knees in meditation. He is not dallying with a brace of courtesans, but meditating with two deep divines.
Happy were England would this gracious prince take on his grace the sovereignty thereof.
Marry, God defend his grace, should say us nay.
I fear he will.
Oh, no. Catesby, what says your grace?
He wonders to what end you have assembled such troops of citizens to come to him. He fears, my lord, you mean no good to him.
Oh, no! We come in perfect love for him!
Yes!
So much more, return and tell your grace.
When holy and devout religious men are at their beads, 'tis much to draw them hence. Wow. So sweet is zealous contemplation.
See where his grace stands, 22 clergymen!
Look you! A book of prayer in his hand! Famous Plantagenet! Lend us your ears! And pardon us the interruption of thy devotion and right Christian zeal!
I do suspect I have done some offence that seems disgracious in the city's eyes!
You have!
Yes!
You have!
Yes.
Would it might please your grace on our entreaties to amend your fault?
Elsewhere for breathe I in a Christian land!
No, then, it is your fault that you resign the supreme seat, the throne majestical, the sceptered office of your ancestors to the corruption of a blemished stock. This noble isle doth want her proper limbs.
Yep, proper limbs.
We heartily solicit your gracious self take on you the church.
Yes!
And kingly government to this, your land.
Yes!
Your right of birth, your empery, your oath.
Alas! I know not whether to depart in silence or to speak bitterly in your reproof. Your love deserves my thanks. But my desert, unmeritable, shunned your high request. God be thanked that there is no need of me. The royal tree hath bore us royal fruit, which mellowed by the stealing hours of time will well become the seat of majesty and make no doubt us happy by his reign. On him I lay what you would lay on me.
You say that Edward is your brother's son.
So say we too.
Yeah.
But not by Edward's wife.
What?
For first, he was contract to Lady Lucy. And second, by substitute betrothed to Bonner, sister to the King of France.
These both put off a poor petitioner, a care-crass mother to her many sons, a beauty waning in distress widow even in the afternoon of her best days, made prize and purchase of his wanton eye, seduced the picture knight of his degree to base declension and low bigger. By her, in his unlawful bed, he got this Edward, whom our manners sort of brings.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Good then, my lord. Take to your royal self this proffered benefit of dignity.
Oh, do good, my lord, treat
him. Refuse not, my lord, this proper time.
Oh, make them joyful. Grant their lawful suits.
Alas! Why would you heap these cares on me? I am unfit for state and majesty.
If you refuse it, as well we know your tenderness of heart, your kind, gentle, effeminate, remorse. Yet no. Were you to accept our suit or no, your brother's son shall never reign our king.
Never reign our king!
For we will place some other in the throne at the disgrace and downfall of your own hands.
Yes.
In this resolution, here we leave you.
Come, citizens! Sound on it, treat no more!
Oh, do not swear, cousin!
I'll call him again, sweet prince, if you accuse them, all the land will ruin.
We'll call him again! I'm not made of stone!
My Duke Buckingham!
Dear citizens,
cousin of Buckingham, and you sage grave gentlemen, since you will buckle fortune on my back, I must have patience to endure the load. But God, he knows, and you may partly see how far I am from the desire thereof.
Oh, God bless your grace, we see and we'll say it.
We salute you with this royal title. Long live King Richard!
Long live King Richard!
England's worthy king.
Amen!
Even when you please, since you will have it, sir.
Then tomorrow, we will attend
Your Grace.
And so most joyfully, we take our leave.
Farewell, gentle friends.
Hey, good.
Come, let us do our holy task.
Ha 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 ha.